seconds late now. Welcome to today's meeting of the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority, which contains the annual meeting for 2017-18. Gives me great pleasure to welcome everybody here today to what is a historic occasion. Can we ensure that all phones are switched off or on silent? And can we remind all members and officers not to do what I did and to use the microphones to press the button when they're speaking so that we can all hear what everybody's saying, especially for those, as I used to be, sitting in the public gallery, because it's quite difficult at times to hear. So you have to get quite close to the mics, apparently, so that people can't hear.
No.
Both myself and Mayor Anderson, Councillor Davies, and a number of other political representatives on Wednesday, was it, Joe? Yesterday, put together a hastily convened get-together gathering at the pierhead, which obviously recognised the terrible tragic circumstances of what happened in Manchester on Monday. But I do think, even though we've done that as a combined authority area, I do think it would be appropriate for the combined authority itself to observe a minute's silence. So I'd ask everybody to stand, please. As this is my first meeting as the Chair, and as the Metro Mayor, it's incumbent on me to make a short opening statement, as this is the annual general meeting. It also seems like a suitable moment in time to both take stock and look ahead. So firstly, I'd like to thank all members of the Combined Authority and all of our excellent officers for the brilliant work they've done over the last 12 months. I'd especially like to thank Mayor Anderson and Councillor Davies for all their previous work as chairs of the Combined Authority and for the clear purpose and energetic leadership they provided to us in our city region. Devolution has given us an enormous opportunity but also some serious responsibility. During the recent election campaign, I set out a number of policy pledges founded on a vision for the kind of city region that we want to create. Those five themes are ambitious, fair, connected, green and working together. They're the pillars on which we will make our policy, set our priorities and deliver our key programmes. To put it in its simplest possible terms, my role and the role of the Combined Authority is to rethink, reposition and remake our city region. Our vision must be to deliver a confident, dynamic and prosperous area that will be a positive economic creative asset for the whole UK. We're here to drive prosperity, encourage innovation and expand opportunities for people and communities in every part of our region, and we are absolutely committed to achieving that goal. We're lucky to live in a place with an extraordinary story and outstanding physical, natural and economic assets. We have one of the most recognisable brands on the planet and an abundance of creative talent and energy. Devolution therefore gives us an opportunity to fulfil our potential. It's a new begin and a chance to create politics that's rooted in the values that we all share and the things that matter most to all of our communities. We're not here to add another layer of government or bureaucracy, but to provide strategic and joined up leadership, bringing our whole region together by pooling our strengths and talents to mutual advantage. It's clear clear from the recently commissioned State of the City Union report led by Professor Michael Parkinson that we have a region that boasts outstanding assets but also contains some areas of acute deprivation and disadvantage. Resolving that paradox and creating the basis for prosperity that provides opportunity for every one of our borders and communities stands out as our biggest challenge. So in that context, I want to say something about one particular and immediately relevant initiative that encapsulates both the strength of our core assets and the scale of our ambition in our city region. The devolution deal signed in November 2015 committed the city region to conduct the science and innovation audit with government support. I'm sure that David Paul will say more about this in his presentation later, but I'm pleased to report that the work is now being concluded. And I'd like to thank all those from local and national agencies, academia and business that have contributed to this vital project. The audit has been a rigorous and, to a certain extent, I gather, a very hard-nosed exercise. Nonetheless, it identifies three sectors where we have a truly distinctive opportunity on which to capitalise, and these are materials chemistry, which is exemplified by the materials chemistry factory, a collaboration between Wirral's Unilever and the University of Liverpool. Infectious disease, typified by the Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine and the Biopharma Cluster, and high performance and cognitive computing, epitomised by the Hartree supercomputer at Halton and the groundbreaking work being undertaken in our universities. That audit is part of a national exercise and it gives me great pleasure to have endorsed it as the Metro Mayor as we now submit it to government for their further consideration. And we will of course have the opportunity to deliberate the audit in much more detail in due course. I've previously spoken about raising aspiration for all. So, as a combined authority, I can assure you all that we will work tirelessly to make this a city region that delivers opportunity and prosperity for all our people in all of our communities. And I'm looking forward to working with everybody to achieve our common goal. So that's my opening statement. We'll go on to the business and the agenda. Item number one, apologies for absence. Number of appointments which are contained schedule following those council meetings, the AGMs. Can I take this as read, please? And item 7, pages 13 and 14, our next report asks us to make appointments to external organisations, so they depart in what takes this.
The paper's been tabled there and identifies the appointment of representatives to external bodies as set out in sections 3, 2, 3, 4 and 4, 1 of the report. I've had to take any questions now.
Can we agree the recommendations set out on the revised report? Item 8 on the agenda, pages 15 to 18. This is the command of quality forward plan, and it's just for noting. So, can we agree the recommendations set out on page 15? Item 9 is we have a presentation which reviews the combined authority progress from last year, which David Parr will take us through.
Thank you, Mayor. The last 12 months have been a very successful year for the combined authority, and what we'd like to do now is just provide you with a snapshot of the success that's been achieved. It is a snapshot, and there's plenty more that we could have said and that would have kept us here involved in the afternoon. I'll start on governance. So you'll see from the slide that we've completed a significant consultation to move to the mayoral or combined authority model. We've also secured intermediate body status for the combined authority, and that's important so that we can have more strategic influence over the decision making for what projects the European funding will support, and that's a significant part of our work, particularly in terms of accessing the Chrysalis Fund and the Single Investment Fund, which is shorthanded as SIF to some people. And you'll see on that slide that we elected our first city region mayor. Congratulations to Mayor Rotheram. Moving on to our strategic vision, and working with the Local Enterprise Partnership, we've developed our strategic approach under the heading Building Our Future. And you can see there that our priorities are productivity, people and places. This was launched on the 30th of June. We have a £28.3 billion economy and a population of 1.5 million people. Over 80,000 undergraduates and postgraduates. Learners are enrolled within our higher education, and we have a working age population of almost a million people. And there are significant jobs within the city region, well over half a million jobs developing in the city region. And we're developing this action plan together with our business partners, our private sector partners, and with the support and leadership of the Local Enterprise Partnership, who you will be aware are represented here by their chair on the combined authority. Moving on to economic development, it's been another positive year for economic development, and we've delivered £13.8 million of business support programmes through our Growth Hub and our European Regional Development funding. This has helped businesses to provide jobs, to secure employment and to grow employment within the Liverpool City region. And we were able to host a very successful International Federation of Business in 2016, and we're delighted that we will be doing the same in 2018. We were able to, working with Peel and other partners, open the Liverpool 2 deep water terminal. This is a significant addition to the Liverpool City region, providing an opportunity to take the ships after the post-Panama Canal development, which will put Liverpool and the city region back to where it was in the past in terms of a major importer and exporter of It's not just about bringing the past to the present, we've also developed the future and working with LEGO and Dong Energy. We have deployed across the city region and in the Liverpool Bay a significant number of modern energy generating turbines, and this is a strong economic development opportunity for the city region going forward, as we're one of the few areas in the country where tidal power is something that can make a big difference, not just to the local economy but to the UK economy and the energy generation for the UK. On economic development, a number of strategic sites have come forward, and you'll see a list of them there. We could have listed a dozen more sites that are coming on stream, and in particular we're seeing an Alstom development that's also bringing a National Rail Academy to help develop the skills that are required and develop apprentices for the rail industry. And we know the rail industry is a very important industry for the UK as we see HS2 developing going forward. On science and innovation, Mayor Rotheram's already touched on this, so I won't dwell on it, but I think it's worth reminding ourselves that this is a position of excellence for the Liverpool City region, and we're very proud of the development of science, and ranging from infection through material chemistry to high performance and cognitive computing. That innovation excellence and that science development is right at the heart of the development. And the consortium made up of University of Liverpool, City Council, Unilever, the School of Tropical Medicine, and the Dartford Science and Technology Facilities in Halton all put us in a very strong place to take this agenda forward. And thank you to Catherine Donnell and others who have driven this agenda forward, working very closely with the university and the local enterprise partnership. On funding, it's important that we utilise the money that we do have as wisely as we possibly can, and by establishing the single investment fund we've been able to do that. The first call on projects has been brought forward. We have now over 100 projects submitted seeking in excess of £300 million of SIF. 48 projects have been invited to submit business cases, and the first six projects have already been allocated resources and are starting to come out of the ground and deliver business growth, business opportunity and economic growth within the city region. On funding, we've secured £72 million of local growth funding over 4 years, and that's one of the highest allocations that's been achieved, and I think that's a testament to the hard work of all of us working collectively together and the political leadership from the combined authority and the local authorities to deliver that, working in partnership with the local enterprise partnership and business. The Chrysalis funds also been novated to the city region, giving us the opportunity to have greater influence and decision making over that capital fund, which is helping businesses to develop, to grow, and innovative businesses to develop in the city region. Transport's been, a huge success. We've seen a £460 million project to replace the Mersey Rail fleet. This will ensure that we're seeing quality vehicles, performance will improve and capacity will improve, and all that will have great value to our transportation network, enabling us to move people from home to work, from home to education, and from home to play. It's a very important investment in the city region. We've also been building the case for very important east-west high-speed rail link to the city region. HS2 is very important to the country, but to us, HS3, or the direct east-west link, is equally important and will build on the port strategy, moving goods across the country as well as moving people across the country. We've also seen significant other funding, and Mersey Gateway is progressing and will open in the autumn of this year, improving the connectivity within the city region. The key route network is also a fundamental part of the city region deal, and sees a coming together and a managing of that key route network so we can ensure people can move and be business can move effectively across the city region. It's important we have people with right skills and right employment opportunities so that we can take advantage of the business opportunities that are being created by businesses large and small in the city region. And you'll see on this slide that we've delivered 30 of 33 skills capital projects worth £21.5 million. The almost £30 million Ways to Work ESF programmes also help residents into work, and there's a number of other grant schemes, as well as completing the area-based review of our colleges and preparing our young people and our not-so-young people for the skills for the future so that they can have a productive career and they can maximise their potential. On housing and planning, the City Region has adopted a statement of cooperation to ensure that we work collaboratively on strategic spatial planning priorities, both for our housing and employment sites, and this is something that will be developed over the coming months. We've also produced our City Region Housing Growth Delivery Strategy, and we're commencing work on the Spatial Development Strategy now. Public service reform is important. It's important that we have a public service that's fit for purpose to deliver for the local community. And you'll see on this slide that we've already got 13 themed reviews working on improving the way we do business as a public service. One of those is working on one public estate, and a board has been created and refocused to ensure that we are utilising the public estate to the very best. And the next slide touches on some of the work that we've invested in to ensure that we spend that public money wisely and effectively to avoid duplication and maximise opportunity. I'll touch on health and social care very briefly. We've continued after our health and care summit in October 2016 to explore issues and options with over 100 senior leaders attending. The health and well-being of our community is as important as the business growth within our community, and we continue to collaborate, and in particular Liverpool, Sefton and Knowsley are developing an innovative social care collaboration that will help to keep people well and healthy, and that's something that we are very excited about, the opportunities that that will create. Children's services. Children are obviously our future, and as well as keeping children safe, we need to support our children when we bring them into our care, and we need to do this effectively and efficiently, and there's quite a lot of work going on with our directors of children's services and our other partners to ensure that we keep children safe and we give them the opportunity to maximise their potential through education and vocational opportunity as well as academic opportunity. So in summary, and my final slide, and I make no apology for taking a little while about presenting this because, as I said earlier, the City Region has succeeded, is succeeding and will continue to succeed to deliver opportunity and is making significant progress to deliver on the devolution that it's been given and it's negotiated with government. The single investment fund worth £500 million over 5 years will be invested to continue this journey, and we will see there £540 million of funding invested by the combined authority. So not an unconsiderable amount of money and a success story.
Thanks, David, and that really is a snapshot. That's just a brief overview of what success in the last 12 months has been for Liverpool City Region. Are there any questions or any questions in regards to David's presentation? And conclude the AGM, but we'll now move on to
some details and some items of ordinary business. Item 10 is apologies for absence. Are there, Judy, any apologies for absence in this?
Yes, Councillor.
And you are. It would be remiss of me not to welcome Councillor Cllr O'Neill before, so apologies for that. Item 11 is declaration of interest.
Have received them, Chair.
Okay. 12 is the minutes of the meeting with Command Authority held on the 21st of April 2017.
Yeah.
13 is public question time, and as you know, we need 3 work days before the meeting of notification of questions. There haven't been any, so not at this moment. 14 is petitions and statements. Now, these are to be notified at 12 o'clock, the working day before the meeting. You have been notified on the 25th, before the 25th, of one item, which is an opportunity for John Baltimore from Merseyside and Cheshire, and West Cheshire, so we've unlocked the democracy group. And I invite John to read his statement.
I'm just asked to read the statements, but can I first of all just thank you. I know this was brought on by the new constitution for giving us the opportunity. I'm John Bolivar, co-ordinator of Merseyside and West Cheshire Unlock Democracy. And we want to ask the combined authority for a local group of Unlock Democracy, the national cross party, no party organization. Voting and political reform. The writing in regard to item 6, which of course you've dealt with, appointments to the combined authority committee on the agenda of today, in particular the appointments to the overview and scrutiny committee. If those appointments detailed the candidate would result in 16 councillors from the ruling party and only 4 from the opposition party. We contend that it is most unlikely that a large majority of councillors on the overview and scrutiny committee from the same political party as the ruling party of the Cllr Mayor, the Cllr Cabinet and all the local councils can perform robust and effective scrutiny of the Cllr CA Cabinet and the Cllr Mayor. We also understand from legislation and statutory instruments that this arrangement is not in the spirit of government and local authority guidelines.
Sorry, John. I'm sorry.
We also understand from legislation and statutory instruments that this arrangement is not in the spirit of government and local authority, the local government association guidelines on scrutiny, which should provide robust and effective scrutiny and need to at least involve the opposition to lead or chair. This requirement, which I have with me, but I'm told I can't read it, this requirement to have a chair, not of the same political party as the Cllr Mayor, is also contained in Schedule 5 of the Local Democracy Economic Development and Construction Act 2009. And our group would wish, request, that each of the 6 local authorities in the Cllr CA elect at least 1 councillor from the opposition party as part of their 3 councillors that they can elect to the overview and scrutiny. This would result in up to 12 councillors from the ruling party and at least 8 from the opposition. The Cllr Mayor and Cabinet have substantial powers, functions and responsibilities. And we contend that the overview and scrutiny committee consisted of up to 12 councillors from the ruling party and at least 8 from the opposition party, that this committee would then be better able to provide strong and effective scrutiny and accountability. Thank you.
Thanks, John. I'll hand over to Dean and Farr, who will address the issue that you raised.
Thank you, Mayor. In responding to petitions and statements, the combined authority would normally provide a written answer to ensure that the combined authority can fully and properly research the matter and provide a comprehensive response. However, on this occasion, because we've done quite a lot of work on the Constitution, we're able to answer the matter now. So, in answer to your statement, the legislation that regulates overview and scrutiny committees for combined authorities prescribes the political balance rules to be applied to that overview and scrutiny committee. The Constitution that was agreed by the combined authority earlier on this agenda makes provision for that political balance to be consistent with the Liverpool City Region geography political balance, and therefore the committee has been constituted in accordance with that legislation, and at present that legislation requires the membership to be 80% Labour, 10% Liberal Democrat and 10% Conservative, and that is the structure of the overview and scrutiny committee in accordance with that legislation.
Thanks, David. Councillor Pitt, may I answer?
Yeah, I just want to make 2 points. First is that this organisation, and I don't judge involving it personally, but I absolutely find it an insult to me and to this cabinet and to the members of scrutiny that the suggestion that we can't perform a robust and effective scrutiny for city meeting combined authority. That's what it states, and that's what's just being read out. I resent that. I think we have many opportunities to scrutinise, debate in an open and transparent way all of the decisions that we make. And indeed, I would also ask him to read the Constitution again, because the scrutiny panel, it actually states that the chair of the scrutiny panel would not be a member of the ruling group. So effectively, that means that there's an opposition position to be taken on scrutiny by an opposition party. So I think you need to bear that in mind. But as far as I'm concerned, I can reassure him alongside my colleagues here that we scrutinise in an open and transparent way everything that we do.
Any comments? I think just to reiterate what Mayor Anderson said, obviously it's the democratic will of the people of the city region to elect their representatives, and we fulfil all of the obligations which are prescribed within the constitution of the combined authority. Okay. We move on to the item 16, which is pages 27 to 36, which is the annual report of the City Region. We now have the annual report of the audit committee, which is John Fogarty, who's going to take us through.
Thank you, Chair. It should be a very straightforward report. It's the Combined Authority Building Governance Committee's annual report back to the Combined Authority of how it fulfilled its term of reference in 2017. I'm happy to take any questions on over at the members of the audit committee.
Are there any questions? Can we then agree the recommendations set out on page 27?
We agree.
17 is the Liverpool City Region Executive Capacity issue. Work is underway to determine the combined authorities'